a seat as we gather here for worship today, and it's good to see everyone here. And what a difference a week makes. As we drove into the parking lot this week, we noticed last week these trees were all in their prime glory of red and beauty, and now look at them, there's nothing left. They're gone. Fall has caused it to disappear on us, but we're grateful to be able to be here in this dry and warm place here today. Take out your bulletins. Just a few things to look at by way of announcement. One of those things is just after this service today, we'll have a short, and I emphasize short, it'll be short. There's one thing on the agenda, which is a membership meeting, which is Mark Welshinger has now sold, in the process of selling his house and moving away, and to fill out his term, Kathy Vansel has been nominated to fill out the remaining 9 months of his term, and so we need to vote on that as a membership. So Kathy's passing out the buttons saying vote for Kathy, you know, and all of that. So those political mailings you've been getting, they'll stop after today. We do want to also make a few announcements here as well. Wednesday Bible study, women's Bible study at 1 p.m. at the Family Center. And so just a FYI for that, make special note that you, if you've been a part of that, you need to have lesson two prepared to come and to discuss that. That evening, by the way, we have adult Bible study here at the church, and we're studying the book of Jonah right now. Still jump in with us or talk to me more about that if you're interested. The 15th is going to be the Women's Craft Day, and that's from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. So if you don't have a sewing machine, if you have a sewing machine, bring it along, but the fabric and the lunch are provided, and you can talk to Peggy. Raise your hand, Peggy. We won't make you talk, but raise your hand. There she is, if you have more questions about that. Kids Quest kickoff, that is going to be October 18th. That's a Tuesday night. It's going to be 6 to 7:45. It's basically from preschoolers on up, so kind of a wide range of kids. But we do a little Bible lesson. We do some game time. We do some singing and all of that. And then we'll have a women's ministry meeting October 20th. That's at 6:30. Is that a Thursday night? I think it is. Yes. Is that right? So Thursday night, October 20th at 6:30, and that's open to all the women of Marcel Community Church. Any other announcements?
Just one regarding Kids Quest. I didn't get in the bulletin, but I am looking for little prizes. We have some incentives for kids memorizing Bible verses. So if you'd like to help with that, please talk to me first, and I'll give you a heads up of what we're looking for again this year.
All right. Any other announcements to make the bulletin? Well, if not, I want to just have a scripture up on the screen here that we're going to kind of recite together from Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 and 13. It says, "Put on then, as God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, compassionate hearts, kindness, humility, meekness, and patience, bearing with one another, and if one has a complaint against another, forgiving each other as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all these things, put on love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony." All right. Why don't we pray as we get started here today. Father, we do thank you, Lord, that we can gather in your house, we can lift up your name and worship and praise. We pray and ask, Father, today that as we do this, that these songs we sing would be expressions of genuine praise from our hearts to you, and that we would also encourage one another as we encourage our brothers and sisters in Christ that they're not alone in this journey of following you, that there's people side by side that have the same hope, the same calling, same eternal destiny in Jesus Christ. And Lord, I pray that you would encourage our hearts through this time that we have worshiping with your people here. In Jesus' name, amen.
Would you stand with us as we open with a hymn this morning?
When we walk with the Lord in the light of His Word, what a glory He sheds on us. Abides with us still. delights of his love until all on the altar we lay. For the favor he shows and the joy he bestows are for those who will trust and obey.
Trust and obey,
for there's no trust and obey. Then in fellowship sweet, we shall sit at his feet, or we'll walk by his side in the way. What he says we will do, where he sends us we'll go. Never fear, only trust and obey. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Not abandoned, and in your image we were made for you. Not only do you know our names, you know the number of our days. Forever we will lift our praises to you. Washed beneath the fountain, with your forgiveness, we have been made new. Oh, send us out into the world to tell about your perfect love. Your everlasting joy will overtake us.
Next to you. much. Go ahead and find a seat. Okay, as you all know, today is Pastor Appreciation Day. And I think everybody here will agree we have a pastor we appreciate.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
All right. Actually, we appreciate his whole family,
yes,
Mara, Daniel, and Nora. So when we got Matt, we got the whole package. And the last 2 weeks, we've been passing around a card, and they've been putting a little money in it. So Matt, we would like to give this to you. And you can this afternoon, you can sit there and read what we really think of you.
Well, that could be interesting. But yeah, no, thank you very much. Yes, yes, thank you. And I know it's Pastor Appreciation Month, but it's also Congregation Appreciation Month, I would say. And I just want to say what a blessing it has been to be a part of this congregation for another year. And it has been a joy to serve here and to be able to minister to Marcel Church and the community. And so thank you for giving us that privilege and that opportunity. We really appreciate all of you and your generosity and care. I'm going to talk this morning about one of the community. And my struggle this week in the sermon was saying, but we already do that so, so well. And it's not from the top-down direction. It's you guys just have a love for each other. In the words of 2 Corinthians or 1 Corinthians chapter 4, Paul will say that you have been taught by God to love one another. It has come from the Spirit of God inside of you. And we feel that, and we feel that with each other. We feel that with the community. So thank you for allowing us to be here serving alongside of you guys. I want to take some time to do a little bit of prayer and praise this morning. And we mentioned already a few updates and things to add to our list from our bulletins in Sunday school already. And one of those is, several of those is just an update on Becca, that she's close to the end of this round of radiation treatments. Keep her in her prayers that when they do the scans, that is good news for her. We did get a little bit of an update. We have a couple different people that know about Lynette, but looks pretty tough right now with different things, so we just going to keep Lynette in our prayers. We're grateful that Charlie has been pain-free for 3 days with his knee. We're praying for like forever on his knee, but we'll keep him in the prayers. I want to pray for Jess, who's having some tests next week, and then gallbladder surgery the following week. Pray for her. Do want to pray also for Bill Schaefer, that has found out he has a blockage, and they're going to do a angiogram to see, can they just put a stent in there? We're going to pray that that is what happens. They don't need to do more. And we're just praising the Lord. Bill Cans is with us today and grateful that he's doing well. So we're praising the Lord for that. Any other prayer or praise you want to lift up here this morning? Yeah, Pat.
I want to thank you for the prayers for my sister Cindy. She had her surgery on Wednesday morning.
Okay. Okay, yep.
So keep her in your prayers.
Keep Cindy praying for Cindy, yes. Anybody else? Yeah, Tammy.
I just want to add to Lynette's prayer request. The last request that came out was she probably only has a couple days left.
Yeah.
And they were going to try to get all the kids in there. She's 10 kids. And they did post a picture with her with the youngest child, so they did make that happen, but she doesn't have much time.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, Desiree.
My dad, Jesse, it's kind of a prayer interface. My dad, Jesse, has been finally selected after 5 years to go undergo a year of her chemo treatment that will hopefully get rid of his next cancer.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, definitely. For prayer for Jesse that that treatment goes well for neck cancer. Yes. Yeah, Joanna.
Just for my sister-in-law, Becca. She's in the ER right now. She has kidney stones.
Okay.
But they're not running the right tests for her. She's not getting really good care. So just pray for her.
Okay.
Okay, definitely. Okay.
Sue, my friend Sue is home. She has two more rounds of chemo to do, but the brain cancer, the lump is virtually gone off. You know, it doesn't show anymore. So
okay.
Just keep praying for her.
Yeah, absolutely. Where else? Yeah, Jane.
Down in, we do some work with a place called Hope Farm School down in Stockholm, Wisconsin. And it's a farm school for boys that are at risk. A lot of them were either have the option of going into juvenile detention or falling through the cracks. But anyhow, it's been thriving, doing well. But in the past 6 months, we have been under just unbelievable spiritual attack with sickness and surgeries, and we had a shadow student bring drugs in this week, and some of our kids got high, and we have our big open house next weekend. So if you would just pray for the Hope Farm School, for all the leadership, and just that Satan would just get the heck out, because it's been an absolute mayhem and chaos. So
I'm sorry,
really
covet
your prayer. So thank you.
Absolutely. Yeah. Anybody else? All right, let's go ahead and pray. Father, we are thankful, Lord. You have given us every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, and even with this Jane mentioning this, the way in which Satan wreaks havoc in our world today and among those who are most vulnerable. What a target, obvious target that Satan would use to attack young boys who could become young godly men that have Jesus Christ as guiding their life. Such a vulnerable and such an opportunity for Satan, so to speak. And Lord, we just pray against that in the name of Jesus. We pray that the attacks would cease, that Satan would be bound, he would be cast out of this, and that through this there would be tremendous growth that happens spiritually with these boys, that they would recognize it for what it is. This is Satan trying to take them down and to destroy their lives, and that they would want to follow you with their lives and to know that, Father, you are the only one who offered the life abundantly. Satan came to steal, kill, and to destroy, but you came to offer life and to offer it to the full, more abundantly. And I pray that they would see the truth of that and be captivated by the truth of that and to seek to follow you as their Savior and the Lord of every area of their life, and that they would find the freedom that comes from that as well. So we just pray for that school, that they would be able to endure and persevere by your strength, your grace, your power to do this really, really important work. We're grateful, Lord, for the answers to prayer and the positive reports we heard. We think about Sue, just home. Pray for continued healing for Sue. Thank you that the good reports and the scans so far are there. We're thankful for Charlie doing well with no pain. We're thankful for Bill Cans, who's here with us today. Just you have brought him back through some really tough trials. And he is doing really, really well with his health. That is a gift from you. We're thankful for that, Father. We're thankful that Jenna is able to get the care that she needs and that she's able to do bed rest. We pray that you'd preserve this last stretch of the pregnancy. Let it be that she can hold off the preterm labor and contractions and be able to carry the baby to full term, but protect her and have that baby in your hands through the whole time, Father. Lord, we want to just thank you for Carol, even though she mills, even though she had a bit of a fall and got some bruises. Lord, we're grateful, nothing broken. And so we pray and ask that you would help her just to manage the pain in a way that she could still be not have to be less alert in the process of sometimes those painkillers can be. I pray, Father, that you would heal her and restore her. We do pray and ask for Murray and Steve and Cindy and family as they care for her. I pray that you'd fill them with your spirit, give them tremendous amounts of strength, grow them in their understanding of your love and compassion even in this moment. We pray for two Beccas, Father. Becca of Willie and Kathy's niece, who's undergoing the last stage of this round of radiation. We pray that when she gets the results of the scans in a week or two, I don't know what the time frame is, that there'd be good results, good news. There's been a lot of tough news. We want some good news, Father, that we need it. And I just pray that you would please just give her reprieve. We pray and ask for Becca, Joanna's sister-in-law, I believe it is, her sister, that just with these kidney stones, help her to get the care that she needs. Sometimes that can be a struggle with overworked hospitals and perhaps people being stretched too thin. Give her what she needs. We lift up Cindy to you, Father, who just went through this surgery last Wednesday. Pray for healing for her, relief from the pain, and we pray for the next stage where she meets with the oncologist. You know what she needs in terms of this, Father. We ask that you would remove the cancer from her body. We ask that in Jesus' name. And we pray that you would give her just healing and health. Lord, we pray for Jess with the upcoming testing and surgery. Protect her and prepare her for that. Pray for Bill, just as he has a blockage. Lord, we pray that he would not have to have open-heart surgery, that a stent would suffice to deal with this issue, this blockage he's having. But Lord, your hand, this is your man, your follower, your child, your hand upon him in all things, and protect him and give him peace and give him a sense of your presence in his life. Lord, we do pray and ask also for Lynette has this, we've been lifting her up, who has this brain tumor, and it's just looking really not good right now. Ultimately, Lord, we know she is your child, so she never leaves your hand and your care for her. That's what we rest ourselves in right now. But Father, I pray and ask this, is Lord, you know, it says in your word, only you are sovereign over our life and our death, Father. Before one of the days of our life came to be in Psalm 139, it says it was all written in your book. And so, Lord, I don't know if this is the time that you're going to take her home, if you're going to heal her and continue to give her life here on earth. That's what we long for. But, Father, your will be done here, and your wisdom far exceeds ours. So we just surrender ourselves to you and ask that you would rule and overrule and let us have your outlook, not man's outlook on things. Father, we do pray for this church. We pray for its preservation. We pray for its continued caring for one another. We pray for its your work in the midst. And I pray, Father, that you would provide for all that we need. We pray this, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. And I would just remind you as well that if you would feel led at any time to give to Marcel Community Church, there is a box in the back that you could drop a check in, or we are also on Tithely, and that's online giving option as well, just as the Lord would feel, direct you and guide you.
I just want to read from Lamentations 3, 22, 23. You probably know this one maybe by heart. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. You sing a couple verses with us of Great is your faithfulness.
There is no shadow of turning with thee.
I'm going to invite Charlie Balog up here today, and we're excited because Charlie's heading back today. This is our last Sunday for this year, and here's the prayer request for next year, guys. They're humming in May. That's what they're saying. We're going to hold them to it, so we really want to have them, and I've already told Charlie he's got to come up with a few songs for us, and we'll scatter them throughout the summer when he's here, so but we're really grateful we could have him one more time.
It's always good to be here with all of you. It's wonderful people, and you know, wonderful church. So kind and gracious. We appreciate you and love being up here. It's kind of down, not wanting to go back home at this point. But we'll shoot for May. Hopefully that'll happen next year. You know, have things a little more ready and maybe a little more even keel for the summer. So. Thank you and appreciate it.
prematurely. I thought we were going to have to pick you up off the floor with no oxygen on that last one. Really. Well, would you open your Bibles this morning? We're going to be all over the place, but we'll start by reading just Luke chapter 10 is where we're going to be starting from this morning. Luke 10, a familiar story, an account from one of Jesus' parables. Luke 10, verse 25. And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him to the test, saying, Teacher, he says, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? And he said to him, what is written in the law? How do you read it? And answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, you have answered correctly. Do this and you will live. But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, and who is my neighbor? And Jesus replied, a man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest who was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, and pouring on oil and wine, and when he had set him on his own animal and brought him to the inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I'll repay you when I come back. Which of these 3 do you think proved to be the neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? And he said, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, you go and do likewise. Let's pray. Father, as you open up your word this morning, we just ask for your Spirit's illumination and teaching. And Lord, there's going to be a lot of different scriptures we look at today. And so, Lord, I pray that ultimately you do your Spirit's work through your word. So we just ask that you would speak to your people here at Marcel, and that you would use your word to convict, to encourage, to guide, to direct, all of it so that we may be fully equipped for every good work that you call us to, Father. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. There's kind of a reality that people have been talking about lately especially, but actually it was developed several years ago. It's the term compassion fatigue. That term first actually came in 1992 by a nurse who noticed that sometimes, nursing field especially, there could be this point in time where they become so fatigued by all of the demands of the needs of nursing that they would eventually kind of just wear out. They'd be fatigued. They would be doing their jobs but going through the motions. They stopped having that compassion and care for the people that they were serving. Compassion fatigue, as defined by WebMD, which is where I do all of my doctoring, by the way, is on WebMD. I have 4 or 5 tumors, you know, but it's all good. They define it as physical, emotional, and psychological impact of helping others. I thought this must be what wives have for their husbands, too, because they seem to have a lot of fatigue for their husbands when they're sick, so that must be what the problem is. But we're fatigued by the needs that are around us. Medical staff, especially through the past couple of years of COVID, people in the human resources department dealing with all of the challenges are fatigued by all of those cares. Some people have spouses that have long-term needs, memory care needs, physical needs, health concerns that have brought them to a place of being very fatigued. And especially for those in the counseling and the pastoral and other helping professions of all sorts are very fatigued by all that's going on. Even if you're not in those fields, though, it's easy to be fatigued by what we see around us, isn't it? It seems like no matter where I turn on the television or where you're looking in the ads, everybody has needs. There's always starving children in Africa. And they show us pictures on the television that say, you should, you must contribute to this. There's the kind of needs that we see right now with the hurricane victims in Florida. And by the way, I think we should help so that we can. but it gets overwhelming with the amount of needs that we see down there. There's always battered women's shelters and homeless shelters that have needs for people to volunteer, needs for money to run their organization. There's food shelves that need people to pass out their food. There's food shelves that need donations for food. I mean, you could just go on and on and on. And as I mentioned last week, I've kind of, from the generation that might be labeled the activist generation. There's always like, don't just do the minimal, make a difference in the world. So give of yourself wholly and be a part of something that'll change the world and it'll make a difference in your generation. And all of that can be really fatiguing. Because they don't just say, here's an opportunity you maybe want to be involved with. They say, you must do this. Unless you're just a miserable excuse of a horrible person, you need to give money to this, you need to give your time. It gets overwhelming, doesn't it, at times? Well, today we're on our last sermon on our vision mission statement that we came up with last year through a process. And on the back of your bulletins, I want you to look at that statement. We're looking at the last piece of the three parts of that statement. And you should have this statement memorized in your memory by now, but we'll see if that happens. But at least you should be more familiar than you were before. And it says, Marcel Community Church exists for the purpose of glorifying God by, one, proclaiming his word. We talked about that in the first week. If Marcel Community Church is going to be known for anything, I want us to be known as the church that proclaims God's word and stays faithful and true to that until the Lord Jesus Christ takes us or we're gone as individuals or until he comes again. The second piece of that is making and maturing disciples. In other words, we don't want to just be okay with they made a decision for Christ. We want to say that there should be no gap in their life between the day they accept Christ until the day they go into glory. There should be a growing process of growing in intimacy and understanding who Jesus is and being changed by him. And then this last piece is for the caring for the needs of the church in the surrounding community. And what I want to do is today just to kind of very simply walk through four different categories. And I want you to think about a target so that maybe you shoot your 22s at or your bow at or you put on somebody's back or something like that. I want you to think of that target that has the bullseye in the center and then it has these rings that go further and further out. And I want to kind of give us scripturally what I believe is kind of a rubric, kind of a helping us to discern with all of the needs in the world, what are the most obligated to meet needs as opposed to the others that are opportunities but may not be as close to home. Four different spheres, the four different rings that we're going to see. So the first one is closest to the center, and that is our own physical families, our biological families. Turn with me, if you would, to 1 Peter chapter 5. By the way, I warned you, there's going to be a lot of flipping around in the scriptures today, so this is your Bible drill for the week, people. In 1 Timothy chapter 5, Paul makes one of the most striking statements in terms of really putting the pressure on people here. This is in a context of caring for widows, and he's thinking specifically of how the church has a responsibility to widows. By the way, the church always has this responsibility. Israel had this responsibility too, because widows were often some of the most vulnerable in society. This was not an age in which there was Social Security and all this sort of thing or other things that could help. These were very vulnerable people in society, and the Church of Jesus Christ needs to take that seriously and provide for those. But he says this, notice in verse 3 of 1 Timothy 5, he says, honor widows who are truly widows. That's the key, truly widows. In other words, they have tremendous financial needs as well as they have no other care. But it says in verse 4, but if a widow has children or grandchildren, let them first learn to show godliness to their own household and to make some return to their parents, for that is pleasing in the sight of God. She who is truly a widow, left all alone, has set her hope on God and continues in supplication and prayers night and day, but she who is self-indulgent is dead even while she lives. Command these things as well so that they may be without reproach. But if anyone does not provide for his relatives, and especially for the members of his household, he is denied the faith and worse than an unbeliever. Now that's some strong language from the Apostle Paul. He's saying that if there is relatives and there is members of their own household who are not caring for the members of their own physical household, they have denied the faith and are worse than an unbeliever. Now, go back to your days of memorizing the Ten Commandments, right? And that one that you read is honor your father and mother, right? You know, you thought about that commandment. You thought, okay, I'm going to make sure my kids hear about that one, right? I want them to know, honor, obey, don't smart mouth me, kid, you know, that sort of a thing. But what's often not recognized is that in the original context, in Exodus chapter 20, honor your father and mother was as much for adult children as it was for the little kids in the house. In a society that does not have a social security system, in a society in which there are no retirement funds, there would come a point where your mother or your father would no longer be able to provide for themselves, to work, to make a living. And in that context, the safety net, the social safety net, was your kids. So one of the reasons why he wanted a lot of kids, take care of you when you reach that age. There is a need for them to care for their own people. And so to honor your father and mother was just as much for the adults as the kids to say, care for your aging parents as they have needs that arise. That doesn't mean you have to take every parent into your home. It means you provide for them. You make sure they're not destitute. They're not impoverished. Their needs are taken care of. And notice in verse 16, though, Paul gives us a little bit of a purpose for why the family should be the primary line of care for the widows, and we might extend that to all who have physical needs within our families. And it says, if a believing woman has relatives who are widows, let her care for them. Let the church not be burdened so that it may care for those who are truly widows. In other words, the first line of responsibility is to be their own physical families. That's who's supposed to take care of them. There'll be some people who don't have the children. Maybe their children refuse to take care of them in disobedience to the word. Maybe they don't have children. Those are those that the church family comes around and helps support. But he doesn't want it to be an excessive means of burden to the church of Jesus Christ. I remember in a church I served, there was I was young pastor, solo pastorate, you know, we would hear about a need that would come up among maybe somebody in the community or in the church family. And I was young and zealous, and so I thought, there's a need. We need to give them something. We need to help them. We need to start a food train. We need to provide for them money. And then there would be one elder who would always kind of probably internally sigh at, oh, here he goes again. But he would say, they've got family. Let's just hold off a little bit and see if they come up to their God-given responsibility. If they drop the ball and we can't talk with them and get them to do that, then we'll step in. But we're going to let the family do their God-given responsibility. And then he would quote some version of verse 16, the church need not be burdened by those that the first line of care is their own family. Let them try it out. Let them do it. I think the church sometimes helps out too quickly in those cases. That maybe a little bit of encouragement to the family. This is your elderly parents. This is their situation. You need to be the first line. We'll come and support you in that. We'll help you. We'll pray for you. We'll provide the needs that we can, but this is your responsibility. So in this bullseye, the very first center of the bullseye of those that we are most highly obligated to help is our physical families. That's most obligated. We need to help them. We need to support them. Second, moving a realm out, is our immediate church family. John 13:35, when Jesus was kind of on his last times with his disciples, some of his parting words beginning that time of the night of his departure, it says in verse 13, verse 35, a very famous verse that I'm sure you've all heard, but it says, by this all people will know that you are my disciples, if you love one another. Jesus said that one of the distinguishing marks of the Church of Jesus Christ, that one that would tell people that don't even know what Christianity is all about, that they would say, I think these guys are Christians because they care for each other on such a crazy high level. They love one another so well. And then Jesus said, they will know you're Christians just by the fact that you're caring for one another. Are Christians known for that today? Sometimes yes, maybe sometimes not. It pains my heart when I see how many Christians sometimes are shooting at each other and trying to tear each other down when really we need to be building each other up. The early church, when they lived out this reality in Acts chapter 4, they lived it out well. They took it seriously. Acts 4, verse 34 says, "There was not a needy person among them, for as many as were owners of lands or houses and sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold, and they laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need." This was a voluntary thing. This was not some communistic, communal kind of thing where everybody has sold everything and put it in a big pot. This was, as their needs arise, the Spirit of God, alive and well in the believers' hearts, would move them to say, "I want to give to that. I want to give to this need." And sometimes it would even lead them to selling houses or land or whatever else to earn that extra money to give to the needs that are there. It was something that flowed out of their love. There is a sense in which the church, local body, big church too, but local body, is a family. Some people have a problem with that because they've had their own family background that maybe was kind of super dysfunctional, really ugly, nasty, mean, whatever. That doesn't deny the fact that the Church of Jesus Christ, the local bodies of believers, are in a real sense a family. Even though some people have bad families, I hope they can learn what a better family looks like, a godly family in the Church of Jesus Christ. We can't throw away that language of family. Some people have had bad human earthly fathers. We don't throw away the language that God is our Father. We recognize that our earthly fathers were not at all the ideal, but God is the perfect Father. We're called in the Church of Jesus Christ brothers and sisters. How many times does that appear in the New Testament letters to the churches? Brothers, 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 brothers and sisters. That's family language. God is called our Father. That's family language. We're called the household of faith. The household was the family unit. That's family language. We are a family, and as family, we are to care for one another. Now, this is sort of the point where I got to the sermon. It says, "Wow, what am I going to say?" Because you guys do care for each other exceptionally well. I would say that Marcel Church has been, and different churches I've been in, cares better than any other church that I've been in. I hear about stuff secondhand, thirdhand through people that so-and-so brought a meal over to so-and-so and somebody gave them a donation for this and they heard they're having a hard time. And if I were to stand up here today and say, "I know there's somebody here that has a need, they're going through a difficult situation, they're going through a financial crisis, they're going through a health emergency," I would have so many people approaching myself or Mara afterwards that would just immediately, they want to help, they want to be there, they want to support. So, blessings to all of you for being that kind of a family. I love the fact that in order for the church to help, the church is not the organizational structure. The church is the people that gather here at Marcel. So, you might, just of your own, not say, "I want to work this through the board and get it around." You on your own say, "There's a need and I want to just make sure and help." They just care naturally. It just flows. That is a tremendous blessing we have. Thank the Lord for that. And let's keep on keeping on with that, because that's something that can be lost as well. So praise the Lord that this is such a generous, loving, compassionate church that cares for itself well. A third realm on that bullseye, physical family, goes out to the church family. It goes out to our extended church family. And that's people that are Christians, but not necessarily a part of our specific fellowship. Notice 2 Corinthians chapter 8. There's a sense in which we could use the language of church and speak of the church universally, all true believers of all time throughout all ages. And then there's this specific sense of a local body, the church. I'm speaking of the bigger body, the people that are beyond the people we bump into or see. The Apostle Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 8 was taking up a collection. Actually, he did this for a lot of his missionary journey. He was taking up a collection for the impoverished Christians in Jerusalem. So he'd go around all over the Roman Empire, start churches, and then he would encourage them, "If you want to give to this cause of the Jewish Christians in Jerusalem, boy, it sure do a lot to bridge the gap between Jew and Gentile tensions. Boy, there's a big need there. If you want to give to that, I'm taking a collection." Notice what he says to the Corinthians about the Macedonians, though, here. Chapter 8, verse 1. "We want you to know, brothers, about the grace of God that he has given among the churches of Macedonia.
For in a severe test of affliction, their abundance of joy and their extreme poverty were overflowed in a wealth of generosity on their part. For they gave according to their means, as I can testify, and beyond their means of their own accord, begging us earnestly for the favor of taking in relief for the saints. Macedonian churches were Philippi, they were Thessalonica, they were Berea, those churches in that part of what we would say is modern-day Greece. That whole region, he says, just was overflowing with the desire. They were facing their own severe hardships. These are the kind of people that were living paycheck to paycheck. They had their own problems to pay for, and yet they are begging Paul to be able to give some money to the needs of other Christians, Christians they never met, probably Christians they would never meet, way over in Jerusalem. And they were yearning to be a part of what God was doing there. And so they gave beyond their means even. And so there is a sense in which the body of Christ that we share with Christians all over. Marcel, we do it, don't we? We've got missionaries all over the globe. You hear about Christians somewhere else, we're supporting Christians up in Canada, churches that are having struggles up there, they need some help, they need a building project. How many times did a group of guys from this church go up to Canada and help them do some building projects, or we send funds to different ministries that are going on to further the gospel wherever it's at? It's a glorious thing. That's our extended church family that we're generous towards as well, and that's, again, a blessing of God's grace in our midst. And then lastly, on the furthest edge is where our fellow community members. These are not necessarily Christians, but these are just our neighbors. Notice in Galatians chapter 6, verse 10. And as you're turning there, I'll just say this. Most of the New Testament emphasizes that Christians support their physical families and their family of faith, their fellow believers. But there is a times when the love of God is so stirring within our midst and is so overflowing to one another that it's kind of like a cup of love and generosity that spills out broader to the community. We care for our own because we care for our own first, and that's what we're commanded to do. But then it spills out into the broader community. And notice that Paul acknowledges that in Galatians chapter 6, verse 10. He says, so then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, especially to those who are the household of faith. Notice the category? We do good to everyone. We especially focus in on the believers. But sometimes that love spills out. Sometimes we do things in the community. We hear about a need. We hear about some way we can bless. We hear about the fact that we could put on a free Thanksgiving dinner and that might bless some people, so we do that sort of thing. We hear about kids who have tragedies and we give to that sort of thing. We hear about families that are really struggling. They had a fire, their house burned down. We want to help with that. And so that's something that we do. That parable of the Good Samaritan is an example of such, isn't it? This guy wants to know, who's your neighbor? As if I can narrow this down to real narrow, you know. What does Jesus do? I'm not going to give you a definition. Jesus tells him a story. He tells him a sad story, actually. Story of a guy on the road to Jericho to Jerusalem. He got mugged. He got beaten within an inch of his life. He's lying half dead in the ditch. And what happens? A priest comes by. A priest should be somebody that has a lot of care because he's really close to God, right? He's like a pastor, right? He's supposed to be the spiritual guy. What does he do? Besides that, maybe walking on the other side of the road, not making eye contact, might be the best road to go. Don't want to get involved. And then a Levite comes by. Well, not quite a priest, but a Levite did their duty in the temple. These were set apart for God's special use in the temple. What did he do? Same thing. Goes on the other side of the road, just tries to not make eye contact. And then comes by the Samaritan. And we all say the Good Samaritan because we know that the Samaritan's the good guy. Nobody in Jesus' day knew that the Samaritan was the good guy. They thought he was the worst guy. They thought that he's a half-breed, half-Jewish, half-something else. Their worship practices, they didn't worship in Jerusalem. They had their own spot in which they worshiped up in Samaria. They had their own version and translation of the Hebrew Old Testament called the Samaritan Pentateuch. These were guys that most Jews who were really serious about their faith would have despised. And he ends up being the good guy in the parable. And notice, remember that in that what I read in Luke chapter 10. When Jesus gets to the end of it, and that lawyer, he asks the lawyer, okay, so of those three guys, who's the neighbor? And the lawyer doesn't say the Samaritan. He says, well, the one who offered compassion. I won't even say Samaritan because it's just too ugly on my lips. The one who offers compassion. And Jesus says, hey, you go and do likewise. So there is a sense in which every one of us has an obligation to the opportunities that we have, the needs that we see, and the needs that we're in a position to meet. We have an opportunity to show the love of Christ there. We have the opportunity, even if they don't know Christ at all, to be good neighbors, to be people who care. Why do we do it? We do it because we love Jesus and Jesus loves people. We do it because we want to show them that Christians are not a bunch of wacky people that you don't ever want to be around, that there are people who are filled with the love of Christ, and that maybe they don't get you, understand your faith and what you believe and all that sort of stuff, but you know, boy, he's a nice guy to have as a Christian. There's something about him that just kind of intrigues me. We do it because in the reality, we as Christians don't live in thinking that our wallet is so important that I can't spare a dollar. It's temporary stuff that's going to be gone and burned up one day in the new heavens and new earth. Why would I care about having my money control me? We do it, all those things, to show the love of Christ. I do want to make this point, though, because sometimes churches get really fired up about doing good deeds in the community, and that's not bad. I'm not saying that's a good thing. It's something we should do. But that's not our primary mission. Because temporal suffering, as tough as temporal suffering can be, is nothing in comparison to eternal suffering with the person that does not know Jesus Christ. The message of the gospel and telling people the good news of Jesus Christ is always the most important thing. And the other thing comes along on the side to support our mission of sharing the good news of Jesus Christ with people. So I just want to make that clear, that the reason we do these things is not that we're doing gospel work when we do a dinner and when we help those in the community. We're doing it because we've been changed by the gospel and we want to overflow of Christ's love. We want them to experience this relationship with Jesus Christ, and so we extend the love of Christ in tangible ways at times as well. So, closer to the bullseye, the more responsibility you have. The farther you go out, less direct responsibility, more of opportunities. And then on the other hand, I want to say this as well. The Spirit of God can lead us to do a lot of things in different ways, in different times. And you may hear of a need and that just the Lord lays that upon your heart by His Spirit. By all means, do it. By all means, take that opportunity to obey the Lord in what He's directing you to do in that moment. So where do we go with this? Well, Tom Rainier did a study of churches that were dying, and he tried to see, is there any signs of dying churches that are common to all of them? He came up with a lot of different things I won't mention, but one of the big warning signs was the fact that a church that became internally consumed with themselves and giving to themselves and making sure that all of their own building needs are met, and then they start arguing about how good it was in the old days and all of that, internally consumed churches tended to die. Churches that thought of themselves as on a mission to share the good news and love of Jesus Christ with the community tended to be more on the thriving end of things. And so as a church, we have to allow the mission of the gospel to drive in sharing the love of Christ with all those. And so here's our I Have a Dream segment of this sermon series. And I have a dream that Marcel Community Church is a place where families, where husbands, wives, children, grandchildren, and even aging parents are not failing to have their needs met, but rather they have families that are showing the sacrificial love of Jesus Christ that's flowing into their families. I have a dream that Marcel Community Church is where we're increasingly becoming a place where our love for our brothers and sisters would be so authentic, so sacrificial, so real, that everybody in the community would say, I'm not sure I believe what they believe, but boy, I sure want what they've got. I want Marcel Community Church to be a place that's so filled with Christ's love in our midst that it's like we're filling up with love and we're spilling out into the community with love by showing care and compassion for the needs that are in our community, where physical needs are being provided for, but also that our love would drive us to offer them the greatest solution, which is their need of a Savior through Jesus Christ. So Marcel Community Church exists for the purpose of glorifying the Lord by caring for the needs of the church and the surrounding community. And I want to read one last passage from 1 Thessalonians that I happened to stumble across, I believe the Lord allowed me providentially to be there. 1 Thessalonians 4, 9 and 10, that I think speaks to this issue and our church so well. There Paul says, "Now concerning brotherly love, you have no need anyone to write to you." By the way, here's one of the churches in Macedonia that he was bragging up to the Corinthians. Here's one of them. He says, "Now concerning brotherly love, you have no need for anyone to write to you, for you yourselves have been taught by God to love one another." This was the great new covenant promise, that God would write the law on their hearts. What he is saying is, I see evidence of the Spirit of God inside of you because I didn't write you a letter telling you you ought to show this kind of love. God's taught it to you directly, and you're spilling out of love for all people. And says, "For that indeed is what you are doing for all the brothers throughout Macedonia." And then he says, "But we urge you, brothers, to do this more and more." That's our message, I think, for us today. We're doing this stuff. Thanks be to God that he's writing it on all of your hearts to do it. And as the Apostle Paul would urge them, I urge you as well. Let's do it more and more. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, that you've blessed us with a church family that exhibits the love of generosity, caring for the needs of our community, caring for the needs of our body here at the Marcel Community Church. I pray, Father, that we would do it even more and more, that our community would say they are Christians. I know it because of the way they love one another. That they would say that, "I don't know this Jesus they're talking about. I've only heard caricatures and ideas about who he is, but if that's what Jesus does in people's lives, I'm interested. I want to know." And Lord, I pray that you would use us to be a blessing to our community, and primarily first with the blessing of the good news of Jesus Christ. And then, Father, also the blessing of just being able to step in and help care for the needs of those in our midst as well. I just pray and ask, Father, that you would just stir our hearts, direct us, guide us to know where to give generously and where to show the care that Christ has put within our hearts, Lord. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing one final song. Why don't you stand as we sing a verse or so of this song. About 15 minutes.